earliest pumped hydro station was built like more than 100 years ago in Europe. And since then, the technology has gradually improved, but the basic form has been pretty much the same. I think the major change is like they used to have a one pump and one generator. Now it's a reversible pump, but that happened a long time ago, like in the 1930s. And the technology is very mature. And right now, I think it's the lowest cost solution for large-scale energy storage on the power grid. And globally, there are over 140 gigawatts of operational pumped hydro capacity in more than 40 different countries. And pumped hydro today accounts for about 97% of all energy storage on the power grid. And that's a very high percentage. I think if we want to have more energy storage for power grid, we really need to pay more attention to the 97%. The use of pumped hydro has varied greatly from country to country. So today I'm going to talk about the situation in Japan, China, Europe, and United States. Overall, things are going pretty well in Japan, China, Europe, not so well in the United States. In the end, I'll try to explain why. And let's first look at Japan. Japan has, of all the countries in the world, Japan has the largest pumped hydro capacity. It's about 27 gigawatt that's operational, and another 2 gigawatt that's under construction. And Japan's pumped hydro totally is about 10% of its total electric power capacity. And I always think that's very impressive because, you know, compared to the United States, Japan is pretty small. And it doesn't have very big river, and the terrain is not particularly steep. It's got nothing that's comparable to like a Niagara Falls Hoover Dam. But it can build more than United States. And another interesting feature about Japan is Japan actually has more pumped hydro than conventional hydropower. And at first I was curious about that, and then I looked into their history, and I found out what happened there is that they decided their suitable site for water reservoir and their water resource are too precious for conventional hydropower. You see, in a conventional hydropower station, the water only drops to generator once, then it's gone. But pumped hydro recycles the water and use it over and over again. When your water resource is very limited, pumped hydro is just a much more efficient way to use it. So it's not just about electricity, it's about water too. And what we see from Japan is that the major barrier really is not about the site. It's more about the willingness to invest. And then let's talk about China. China has the world's second largest pumped hydro capacity. It's about 23 gigawatt operational pumped hydro. But that is only about 1.5% of China's total electric power. But China has the world's most aggressive program for building. Right now, there are over 30 gigawatt under construction. And in 2014, China has just finished a new round of siting. They identified additional 59 sites with totally 77 gigawatt of planned pumped hydro sites. So in the future, we can expect China's pumped hydro capacity to double in about 5 years, and then double again in about 10 years. So I find it, I apologize, I cannot follow this framework very well, because if you ask me why the barrier prevents being used more, no. China is doing that. I think it's going really well. And then Europe. Europe has about 50 gigawatt of operational pumped hydro. And that's about 5% of Europe's total electric power. And then it also has been building quite a few. There are like 7 gigawatt under construction. And I don't know how many have been planned. But in 2011, in Germany, there was a study on how to get to 100% renewable electricity. And that study pointed out to Norway could be the green battery of Europe. And a corresponding study in Norway also confirmed that, also say it is feasible for Norway to add 20 gigawatt of pumped hydro by retrofitting its conventional hydro power. But later, there was a rebuttal to the idea, and the author made a very good point. The basic point is that Norway's electricity now is almost all from hydropower, conventional hydropower. So it's using hydropower for both base load and peak load. So its balancing potential right now is underutilized. And Germany's vision for 100% renewable is not going to happen overnight. And when in the future, when there are more intermittent renewable electricity, the first step is not to rush into building pump hydro. It to use that the balancing power you already have. So building pump hydro doesn't make sense until you have exhausted your cheaper option. So that reminds me to point out I think not to, what I already say, I think all the conventional hydropower is already a pump hydro. It's just a matter of make sure it's doing the pumping. So we should not just forget about the conventional hydropower. And I know the conventional hydropower is built by putting a dam on river, and dam in the river has a lot of problem. But the truth is there are already a lot of dams out there, and we need to think carefully about how to do it with those dams. If we are going to remove all of them, return all the river back to their pristine state, we are going to have a lot of problems, not just the electricity, but also about water. But if we don't, if we are not going to take down all the dam, we might want to think about how to use them more efficiently. And there are quite a few countries that are similar to Norway, like Finland, Sweden, Switzerland, Austria, to some degree, Canada and Brazil. So you see, Europe got quite a few green batteries. So they are really not in such a big rush to build more pump hydro, even though they are still building quite a few. And North America has Canada, not too bad, and then South America has Brazil. And China actually has a very big green battery in the Southwest, like a 300 gigawatt. And finally, let's talk about America. The United States has about 20 gigawatt of operational pump hydro, and that's about 2% of US total electric power capacity. And this is nothing under construction. In 2014, two new projects received their license. One of them got canceled earlier this year. And the other also still has not started building. I don't really know why. And the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission has issued a lot of preliminary permits for proposed pump hydro project. And what that means is that there are still quite a few investors, and they identify a lot of potential sites. But most of the permit owners right now seem to be just hold down to their permit, not really moving forward. And I guess it's really understandable because natural gas price is low. And with cheap natural gas, you really don't need natural gas. And so why is the big gap barrier? I know I'm not supposed to say that, but really it's not technical because you cannot say China is doing that because they have superior technology and US. It's really not that. It's really economics and institutional. Yeah. And let me talk about a little bit about cost. Right now, most of the pump hydro capacity that exists in the United States are very old. Their capital cost has been fully depreciated. Operational cost is very low. It's usually less than half of a cent per kilowatt hour. So these old stations are very profitable. But if you want to build a new one, the capital cost is pretty high. From what I find in the literature, the levelized cost of electricity for new pump hydro will be somewhere around 20 to 30 cents per kilowatt hour. But today's on peak gas power is only 5 cents, so it cannot compete. But most of people kind of underappreciate one very important feature about pump hydro: they last very, very long. After their capital cost is fully depreciated, they are still running. And who knows how long they are going to run. So let me try to explain the entire cycle. If you build a new pump hydro station in the United States today, most likely you'll be losing money because you cannot compete with natural gas. You will be losing money year after year throughout your depreciation schedule. And because when you keep losing money for so long, you have cash flow problems. So eventually you need to declare bankruptcy. But because the operational cost is so low, you don't shut down the plant because you keep the plant running will actually reduce your cost. So after bankruptcy, what happens is ownership change hand. Somebody else will own that. And eventually there will be a day when all the capital cost is all gone. And this station will suddenly turn into a cash cow. So, yeah, okay. Yeah, it's kind of like that. So we got a dilemma. The dilemma is like, it is really wonderful to own, somebody called old pump hydro is a perpetual money machine. So So it's really good to own a perpetual mining machine, but it really sucks when you try to build one. So if we want to rely on private sector to build more pump hydro, what we are going to need is like a lot of billionaires who are willing to sacrifice themselves for the greater good of society. And that's probably not going to happen. And why China can do that so fast? Because they are doing it with national planning and public funding. Yeah, but Chinese approach also has its pros and cons. You see, if you pay attention to the news in China, the Chinese National Corporation also wastes a lot of money on building zombie factory. But pump hydro is different. Pump hydro is very unlikely to become zombie because the operational cost is very low. Eventually, even if you have to go through bankruptcy, eventually it will become perpetual money machine. In the long term, have a lot of perpetual money machine will benefit the future generation, but the current generation need to pay the price first. So how about America? Does America have the capacity to do that? I'm not quite sure. And I don't think, because the technology is very mature, R&D is not going to make much difference. Subsidy may work, but it depends on how you structure that. The best example in US history I can think of is the New Deal. In the United States, the public sector owned most of the conventional hydropower capacity, and a lot of them were the legacy of the New Deal. And many of them could be retrofitted into pump hydro. The federal government owned half of them. But New Deal was a long time ago. I don't know if it's possible to do that again. And the project that got canceled earlier this year was the public sector project, the Sacramento Municipal Utility District. They already cleared all the hurdles in siting and the environmental permitting, everything else to get the license. But eventually it decided to give up because the cost and financial risk are too high. So that to me, that looked like a very bad omen for public investment for pump hydro in this country. So overall, the outlook for pump hydro in the United States is not good. So let me sum up. Hydro and pump hydro are not available everywhere, but there are plenty of opportunity in many different places. Pump hydro today is already 97% of green energy storage. With so many projects under construction now, in the future, quite likely the percentage will become even higher. And if we further add conventional hydro and pump hydro together, yeah, they could be a really huge part of the solution. I don't know whether that'll be enough for decarbonizing the last 20%, but if we don't have that, it will be even more difficult. Thank you.